Good evening, sir. Sir, sir, let us start. It's 4:35. We would admit the participants as and when they come in. So let us start. And
thank you. Right. Thanks, Shantan. Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm Tapas Dasgupta. On behalf of the Manufacturing and MSME Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry, it is my proud privilege to extend a very hearty welcome to all of you to this evening's online discussion on introduction of drone and safety assessment. The exciting session of this evening is being presented by the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry in association with Tech24 Aviation. I'm sure, like me, all of you are eagerly looking forward to listening to our esteemed expert panelists for the session. However, before I introduce them to you, please allow me to point out a couple of do's and don'ts for the session. Firstly, I would like to request all the participants to kindly mute your audio and go off video. As you would appreciate, this is to have a better quality of the presentations and interactions, please. Secondly, please write down your questions in the chat box, mentioning your name and organization, and these would be taken up by our expert panelists during the question and answer session. With that, let me introduce to you our esteemed expert panelists for today, Mr. Virender Singh, Managing Partner, Gap Avia LLP. Mr. Singh is based in New Delhi. And we have Mr. Sundaresan N, Chief Drone Instructor, Tech24 Aviation. Mr. Sundaresan N is based in Tamil Nadu. A warm welcome to Mr. Virender Singh and Mr. Sundaresan N, once again, on behalf of the Manufacturing and MSME Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Well, I'm sure that many of you would have had some experience with drones. And maybe like me, some of you were excited seeing a whizzing, tiny toy-like equipment remaining stationary a few feet away from you, clicking photos at a wedding reception. Well, as you all know, drones have come a long way from clicking photos at events to their present-day usage in logistics, defense, and various other critical areas, providing opportunities for economic growth and career opportunities to aspiring professionals. Again, as expected, along with these numerous applications of drones have come various rules and regulations. I'm confident that our esteemed panelists, Mr. Virender Singh and of Gap Avia LLP and Mr. Sundaresan N of Tech24 Aviation will enlighten us this evening on all these and many more. Talking about the session format, our session format will be presentations from Mr. Virender Singh and followed by Mr. Sundaresan N, which will go on for about 45 to 50 minutes. And then we shall have a Q&A session for the next 40 to 45 minutes based on questions received through the chat box from all of you. With this, I would like to request Mr. Virender Singh of Gap Avia LLP to kindly take over. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Tapas Dasgupta. And the listeners, I'm privileged and obliged to the Bengal Chamber of Commerce to provide me the opportunity to speak to all of you. I have a small presentation on the Indian Aviation and the Gap Avia, brushing about the drone connectivity and the safety assessment. What the basic of the safety assessment and why it is necessity? What's the necessity about having safety assessment? What is always a dilemma between the safety and the cost? People think it's a luxury, but many a times luxury becomes necessity. And the balance between the necessity and the safety is the most important thing. I have a small presentation we'll just share with you. What is Gap Avia? Looks very odd name for the aviation industry. Why it is Gap Avia? Gap Avia means the gap. Avia fills the gap or bridges the gap between the two things. How? We'll come to know slowly after this. I'll just touch it about the current scenario of the Indian aviation, how it is, what it is. Pre-COVID, we are one of the highest growing market in the world. And it was not hidden from anyone and throughout the world, be it an Indian player or the world player, that India is an emerging market. I'm going to be very soon topmost, but the third in the beginning at the global level. Pre-COVID, it was developing like anything. And we have seen the interest from the various international players about it, be it the PPP airport projects, airline projects. If she just refresh your memories, talk about the Navi Mumbai airport project, Goa Mopa International Airport project, Bhogapuram International Airport project, the Jewar International Airport project, where the multinationals has shown a lot of interest into it. Many of them are the known name, the Changi Airport, the Fraport Airport, Incheon Airport, NIIF, which is the current operator for the Bangalore International Airport, many financial institutes, including the NIIF, the Indian Financial Institute, Abu Dhabi Airport Companies, Austrotrad, PNC, Do-It, along with the Indian player, and one of the Indian player is well known now, the Adani Airports Limited. And we have seen how aggressive they were bidding into it. And we have seen the new airport player in the market. One is the Zurich Airport International, which won the Jewar International Airport. Second is Adani's, which is well-known name. But they entered airport so aggressively, they won all the six airports from the Airport Authority of India. If you see the bid comparison between Adani's, it is more than 100% difference. So that was we as in a country, how we were growing about it. It is just a temporary phase because of the novel COVID-19, it's a temporary slump. But the story of Avisense continued to beat all the odds in India. I am delighted to inform all of you, I'm sure you must be aware of it. After opening up the Avisense in 2nd, yesterday was the day when we crossed 1 lakh footfall each day. Yesterday was the first day after the reopening of the Indian Aviation. We have crossed the 1 lakh footfall on particular day. So slowly but steadily we are growing. We very soon will recover the market. But there's a difference now. Earlier it was a metros, which was cultivating the culture of traveling. With the focus on the tier 2, tier 3, or the various schemes of the Government of India, the future is towards the tier 2, tier 3 towns, small cities. I'll touch it upon the Government of India schemes and other things in coming slides, where we'll see how the Government of India is going to touch or promote the Indian aviation. Government of India has a lot of plans, ambitious plans to support the increasing demand for air travel. The objective, we have to have 200 plus operational airport. I'm talking about operational airport. Number of airport are more than 400 in the country. And as claimed by the Ministry of Civil Aviation, Government of India, they have operationalized almost 70 airports in the last 3 years through the scheme called Udaan Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik, or RCS. Almost 700 plus routes have been allocated. 2 days back, the Ministry of Civil Aviation has announced another 72 routes. Another 72 routes under the Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik scheme, RCS. Unfortunately, the state of the West Bengal couldn't get a single route into it, except one bypass route into it. This sector is going to witness huge investment in the tune of 5 billion. Government of India itself is going to put almost 50% of the state, around 1.85 billion, which is a huge number. What for? For the airport infrastructure, developing heliports, helipads, aviation academies. And this is not over a year, it is for next. And this the world player are keen to enter the Indian market, and we have witnessed it. You have seen the Zurich Airport, the bidding of Zurich Airport for Jewar International Airport, which will be a second airport for India capital city, Delhi. It is coming around 80 kilometers from Delhi Airport. And the bidding was per passenger fees model, which is very high number. Today we talk about those numbers. looks like very aggressive numbers, but these people are pumping in huge money, around 4,000 crore to build that airport. They are not dumping the money. They're going to be their business, the world-class airports. It's a visible here. You see, can see the current scenario in India. The trend is from shifting from the government-owned airport or state-owned airport to public-private partnership in the development of the infrastructure. We have seen it in the past, the Cochin International Airport, which was India's first private airport. Then the Delhi-Mumbai were privatized in 2006. Then Durgapur was built as a first private PPP airport in the West Bengal. Subsequently, the government of West Bengal has taken a stake or increased the stake into it. Now it becomes a state-owned airport. How these airports are bringing change into it? The value creation by the private player, the PPP players, there's a huge benefit being enjoyed by the passengers because the new terminal building has come, the new terminology has come, the new technology, they brought it, they generated a lot of employment into it. But all of them comes at a cost and required a lot of experience and competent professionals about it. It doesn't come like this. And if you remember around 15 years ago, what kind of airport we used to have? I don't say there were bus stations, but they were not anywhere close to the international levels. A thrown stone away place called Bangkok or Singapore, you see the airports. We feel to sigh about it, how our airports are. But today, our Delhi airport, Mumbai airport, even the terminal of the Calcutta airport, are world class. Many of the Indian airports owned by Airport Authority of India or a private airport operator won the prestigious award for number one in particular airport category. It is because of the change in technology, terminology, or the participation of public private partnership. So there's a big change is coming in. As in state of West Bengal, what are the opportunities? In current scenario, as on today, what all we have in West Bengal, other than the Kolkata, Bagdogra, is known as a gateway to the northeast, and at Durgapur, which is a different concept of the Aerotropolis. It's not an airport, it's a different concept, Aerotropolis. A city around the airport, and airport is a catalyst for the development of the city. But other than the RCS flight, we could not achieve the major commercial flights to the Durgapur airport. Airports owned by a state, it's an obligation to the state to run the airports. When it is a PPP airport, means they want a return on investment. So return on investment, probably Durgapur airport operator know better than anybody else. I used to support the airport, so I know today still they are struggling into it. But is it sufficient for the kind of a state we are in, West Bengal? I think no. As I said initially, that the traffic and the future is for regional airport, tier 2, tier 3. We have seen the princely state of the Cooch Behar in West Bengal, which was one of the good state, part of the state. But the airport, which is owned by the state, means the Airport Authority of India, and they were owner of the Balughat Malda, which were transferred by the state government to the central government and subsequently taken back from the central government to the state, by the state to develop it. But we all know how the connectivity is there. Cooch Behar is struggling from last 20 years to have a big flight to land it, other than this few small scheduled flights which operate for a very limited time, there are nothing. Malda Balughat. Unfortunately, from last 3+ years or around 4 years, we are still working to convert them from a non-controlled airstrip to a proper functional, at least a low-cost, no-frill airport. I don't know when we are going to end into it. We have to rope in a private-public partnership if it is a kind of a good returns on the investment, PPP model will work. It may not work because of the size of the catchment area. So we have to look for some mediocre way into it, how to do it. Will that be sufficient for a state like West Bengal? 3+3=6, or there will be more. So we have to revive and develop these regional airstrips, maybe Achara, maybe any part of the West Bengal where the demand is, like a Sundarban, there's a huge demand. Can we build a airstrip there? There's ISKCON headquarters, the world headquarters, but we do not have air connectivity there. Maybe a heliport, if not the airport, which need a very small area. So these kind of out of the box thought, we have to think into it, and gap area fills the gap there. The industry and the commerce department of the government can look into it, rethink the possibilities to have the connectivity, because to have industry, we have to provide a faster connectivity and a reliable connectivity. This would not happen, an investor or a industrialist comes, wait there, and then the flight is canceled, which is a non-schedule, and then he has to travel by a road. Probably the state lose the investment or these things. I'll not go into deep about it, but we should need or promote those things out of the box thing to have the heliport, helipad, or regional airstrips where we can have a small aircraft operations. Because if we talk about a Malda, Balughat, or the ISKCON headquarter, Mayapur, or Sundarban, probably we may not get a reliable, confident supply of the customers, passengers, for a smallest aircraft in the Indian market as on date is a ATR-72. Means each flight should have at least, if not 72, 60 passengers for an airline to make profit on it, to sustain the operations. We have seen many airlines has come in the past in Indian aviation, but vanished over a period of around 5 to 6 years. And because of the novel COVID-19, we may see collapse of big airlines along with the regional airlines. So that's the question mark. How to do it? Oh, we need a reliable, small regional connectivity scheme, which may be owned by the state. In the Udaan RCS scheme, the state government provides 20%, 80% is funded by the central government. Airline is a win-win kind of a thing. They also sustain the operation by selling the remaining seats at the market price. It's a win-win for all. The common person can avail that flight at 2,500 rupees for an hour of a flight. West Bengal can be reached from the middle of it, maybe from Kolkata, maybe from Durgapur, from anywhere of the part. Second part is not more than 90 minutes of the reach. So roughly a ticket will cost around 3,000 rupees. That 3,000 a common man can spend. Otherwise, the same 90-minute journey may become 10 to 12 hours of a train journey. What is cost? Time is money today. So we need faster connectivity, the regional connectivity into it. Here, drone also plays a major role into it. To have these facilities, it takes time. It takes a lot of money, a lot of travel, a lot of resources. How do we monitor it? How do we control it, have a proper control? How can we have a dashboard for the Honorable Chief Minister or the Chief Secretary or the Concerned Secretary of the state or the industrialists of the state? We should have a dashboard, and dashboard should be connected through a control system, through a drone management system, which keeps the hawk eye on the project development, monitor day-to-day practices. So drone can play a major role into it. Whatever we have seen the drone in the past 2 years back, since our childhood, the drones were used for the party laws or security forces for various reasons. And things have changed now. To operate drone, we have to get our drone registered with the government of India, and DCA issues a unique number into it. And slowly a time has changed. Recently, around a day back, government has made it mandatory to have a trained pilot. Drone has to be used by a trained certified guy, certified person. It's not that I bought a drone and I can fly it anywhere. Those days are slowly disappearing. Because of what? We have to enhance safety. Safety, security of the people. It's a question of human life you are talking about. Here I'll touch about the gap area, why the gap area is. As I said initially, gap area means we bridge the gap. I know the state authorities always have a competency. Industries has a lot of money, resources. It's only a lack of the subject matter knowledge. We have seen the Kuch Behar, as I said, the smallest princely state of the West Bengal, which is struggling to have a scheduled commercial flight for decades. We have seen the development of the Durgapur Airport, which was developed over the period of around 3.5 years. From a land acquisition to first flight landing, it was around 3.5 years to first flight has landed. How? Because they had the right people at the right place with the right mandate to do it. If we fix everything in the red tapism and the bureaucracy, probably will not achieve the target. The state has to rethink. The Chamber of Commerce has to propose to the authorities. Authority has to agree for it. We need a dedicated team into it, a dedicated corporation body into it. Maybe under whichever department the government thinks. Those people should have a dedicated mandate to upgrade the existing airstrip, helipads, planning of the heliports with the association of the industry, rope in the industry, because at the end of the day, it's a benefit for the common man and industry. So gap area can fill that gap, because the gap area, we have a team of people which is having experience of ranging between 25 to 35 years. The lowest experience is 25 years, and the highest experience is around 36 years. And the 36 year people have worked for the regulator, which is DGCA, maybe a Ministry of Civil Aviation, Airport Authority of India, or the biggest airport operator of the country, which is the GMR, GVK, now as Adani's, or the multinational airports. So we have the right people at the right place, which can assist the people, industry, the authorities, from concept planning, designing, the initial surveys. I said initially, because we have to consider or keep in mind the safety as utmost priority. It comes at a little cost, but the consequences are really very, very serious. Small miss, and we miss or lose human lives into it. Are we ready for it? Probably nobody wants to lose their life. But at the same time, nobody wants to sunk a lot of money in the name of a safety. That's the management dilemma. We will take a call. Are we willing to invest that money, or we can take a risk? Because when the risk convert into the reality, nobody wants to take or owe the responsibility. There's a huge cost, huge loss of the human lives. Same time, because we are governed by such rules, by the International Civil Aviation Organization called ICAO, or DGCA Civil Aviation requirements, there are a hell of a requirement or regulatory approval from the various ministries, be it the Ministry of Home Affairs, or Ministry of Defense, or Ministry of Environment and Forest, or Ministry of Civil Aviation. A lot of formalities has to be done. There are a lot of things is to be considered. What is the going to be impact on environment or the underground resources? What will be impact on the security of the nation into it? Like the location of the Durgapur Airport is very close to one of our best friend in another country. And I don't want to name here it, but we know who is the nearest. And that airport can play a major role in case of a contingencies. So those things have to be considered. And Minister of Home Affairs and Minister of Defense take a lot of time into it. So how to expedite without compromising on the safety? So we need a people who know the subject, by which we can get the approvals on a fast track instead of wasting time. As I said, comparison between the Durgapur Airport and two airports being built by the state last 4 years, we have seen, I have not seen or not heard anything in those airports. Malda and Baruhat. Things are going on. And once we conceive the things, we allocate the tenders for the people. We need a Hawkeye, as I said, maybe by drone, maybe by the human interface to check the quality, quantity, and the safety. We need a project management team. gap area, fill the gap. When we build a beautiful facility like Kuch Bihar, we have done it. Central state, lot of opportunity. But why the airline is not coming? Today, if you want to sell it gold by keeping it in a pocket, there's no buyer. We have to market it. We have to meet the airlines. We have to convince the airlines. We have to convince the industry houses, the people who actually get the benefit out of it. We have to take a stakeholder on board. Need a lot of efforts, a lot of time, a lot of money to do all this. This is post-construction, before the financial go-ahead, when we come get a aerodrome license, get the approval from authorities to go ahead for a landing of a first commercial flight, these things has to be done. Can we do it? Being a part of the government system, I don't say no, but I will not happily say yes. Probably colleagues of mine listening this thing may be well aware it's not easy by wearing the hat of the government of state or the government of central or whatever. We need freedom to do a marketing for an airport to a buyer, which is a general public, be it industries or the tourism department. A lot of things has to be done. We have seen the fate of Sundarban, which is a beautiful facility in West Bengal. Are we able to commercialize it at the full extent? I am of the opinion, no. There's a huge potential. We have to encash it. There's a Digha, untouched barren land, beautiful seashore. Are we able to exploit it? No. Why everybody wants to go to the Goa, not to the Digha? We have to think over. Those marketing activity, we have to rope in the private partnership. They can do it in a better way. And they can get it done. Finally, as I said, the aviation is a highly regulated area. We need to develop so many documentation, so many manuals, not only for submission to the government authorities, for implementations, for day-to-day operations, for managing of that those facilities. They were a bulky document. Instead of roping in a consultancy firm, we should rope in the professionals who can support us to develop those things, submit to regulator, train the people who are going to man those facilities. Probably gap area can do, can assist the industry and the states. Majority of us, or all of us, can see this beautiful picture, which is indicating, looks like the red light, a traffic signal, or red, yellow, green. But as I said, a safety assessment, the subject of the today's discussion, part of it is safety discussion. In India, the safety assessment is governed by the International Civil Aviation Organization's rules. There's a document, there's a DGCA civil aviation requirement. This is just a gist of it, how we do it. It is divided into risk severity and the risk probability. How serious they are, how often they can happen. What are the consequences? The color indicates the consequences. How often they happen, that is on your left, which is shown as a frequent, occasional, remote, improbable, extremely improbable. Bahut zor-zor hota hai, as we do every day in the country, when we look at a red light, which is not in the part of the major part of the city, at the outer skirts of the city, if there's no traffic constable, we look left, right, go. That's a frequent. Risk severity, what it is, what happens if something goes wrong? We are in yellow, means we are crossing a red light at when it is red for me, but still I'm crossing. So we are taking a risk. And what happens if another truck comes which has a grid line, we convert into a red zone, yellow become a red, which is from starting from 5A to 3A. People join from Indian soil, they must have seen all this happening very often. And this is used in airports, heliports, helipad. We do the safety assessment. We measure the risk severity and the probability, how often it goes. My friends from the aviation must be understanding it in a better way. people from industry, I just want to touch it. The green may become yellow, but yellow and red, there's a very thin line. When it converted to red, we lose the human lives. I'll not say anything about the reasons behind, but if you recall our fresh accident, which has happened in the Calicut airport and a couple of decades ago at Mangalore airport, how did it happen? They were tabletop airports. In I will reveal the actual reason about it. How did it happen?
A little bit of interruption for you, Mr. Singh. I guess, you know, we are taking
this a little bit of... Second last slide, sir. 1 minute. Yeah.
If you can kindly close, yes. Then we can go to Mr. Sundar Jason. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry. So safety risk assessment plays a major role into it. We have to choose between the safety and the risk, how we are going to take it. This is the last slide, as Mr. Gupta has said. As I said, something missed somewhere, the measurement dilemma. So I had given a Swiss cheese model, which is world known thing. Swiss cheese has many holes. Holes are the risk. And we put the prevention measures, how to prevent the losses or damage. But one fine day, all the holes are aligned. And when all the holes are aligned, we may convert into incident or an accident. That is the safety assessment, a gist of it. Gap area, fill those gaps and make sure these holes are not aligned into it. We should not head for it. With this, I'll conclude and say thank you, Mr. Dabangal Gupta. Any query, people can send it to the Chamber of Commerce and we can take it forward and we'll reply to it. Thank you.
Yeah, I think I can take care from here. So am I audible to everyone? I think so. And I'm sharing my screen now, right now.
Go ahead.
Can you see my presentation? Yeah.
Yeah, we can.
Sure. Okay. So without wasting much time, let me jump directly to the drone part as well as the safety assessment has been covered by Virender sir a little bit. And I'm jumping directly into the drone part. So what we will see is like, this is going to be the part of the webinar. Like I'm going to take only 20 to 30 minutes maximum, and then you can have your questions. And we're going to see an industry overview, drone technology applications, and different regulation parts, as well as the different available developer platforms and the ongoing developments and final thoughts. So, okay, so industry overview. So drone is going to touch every industry. So you can see we have lots of industries from agriculture to railways, aviation, defense, okay? So in agriculture, let me tell you how the drone is going to affect the agriculture. Agriculture, we have, this is the backbone of our country. We have lots of farmers, then IT tech guys. So the agriculture in the drone is going to be used for spraying activities and crop management and lots of things. We have also seen that the drone is used for spraying activities and controlling locust attacks across the Rajasthan and so on. We have heard of that. So that kind of drones is going to be used in the agriculture industry for spraying and minimizing the cost to the farmer's life as well as improve the safety of farmers and so on. And in aviation, we're going to have lots of transportation, like taxis, flying taxis. It's been developed, and you know, we have seen lots of news across many countries like Dubai and Japan. They are developing this kind of air taxis in aviation. So in future, in not much more, like for in 5 to 10 years, we will be having lots of air taxis across Indian airspace. That is what I believe. So because of the fast growing technology in drones, so I believe the aviation air taxi is going to be a major thing. And so a construction, construction, if any people from construction industry, the drones are being deployed to monitor the resources as well as the track the workers, labors, and so on. And defense, we know surveillance and reconnaissance is the major applications, and for monitoring the borders and e-commerce, we're going to have a very big impact on e-commerce, like Amazon and Flipkart. These are the big players coming into the market for delivery, right? So we will be having a delivery system for e-commerce industry, and we are into the education and training industry. I'll come back to that later. And infrastructure, we have lots of things going on in infrastructure, from railway road and like road inspection, bridge inspection. Infrastructures and insurance. I want to talk a little bit of about the insurance industry, because most of the drone companies are working on the technology part, developing the technology like flight controllers, autopilots, and so on. Insurance, it is going to be a very big thing, because lots of crashes and liabilities is going to happen, because it is inevitable, because we have cars nowadays, and we insure our cars. Like the drone is also going to have insurance policies, and we're going to have pilots insurance, drone insurance, liability insurance, and so on. Manufacturing, very, very big topic. I'll come back to this in an upcoming slide. And power and utilities inspection, like carrying out power line inspection. And I'm generally talking about the mass benefits for these industries, power and utilities, as well as real estate. In real estate, they use for photographies and lots of things. And oil and gas, same for inspection, carrying out pipeline inspection. They will be fitting some sensors, and I'll come back to that also. And we have, so it is going to impact every industry in India. It is already impacting in future, like even drone can become another sector for contributing the economy also. So let's give an overview of drone technology. So according to me, how I instruct people, because I'm an instructor, I used to teach people about the drone technologies and piloting and so on. So I categorize these things in three ways, like fixed wing aircrafts, you can see one here, and multirotors. It will mostly, you people have seen this, this being called as a drone, and a quadcopter. This is actually a multicopter. And we have a hybrid drone, the combination of fixed wing and the multicopter together. The advantage of hybrid, it is going to have lots of endurance, as well as it can cover lots of range. So that's why, that is a major reason why the delivery e-commerce sectors, and they are focusing on developing the hybrid UAV, because it can take off from anywhere and it can land on anywhere, and you don't need much space for like conventional takeoff and landing. You don't need to do that. So that is the one reason we are going for hybrid aircrafts, hybrid drones. And when we talk about any drone systems, it is going to have all these components inside. You need transceivers and GCS systems. A transceiver is nothing but the communication part, how we going to communicate with the drones. And GCS, it is nothing but ground control station, which is nothing but a simple laptop with softwares and integrated hardwares, which is used for communicating with the drone. So we will have you might have seen transceivers, the people who are using the commercial drones, they use manual controls like transmitters for controlling. Even you can have a GCS, the professional drones will have GCS systems, which is used for controlling. And every drone will have a flight controller or autopilot. It is like a motherboard, which we use in our, it is a brain of the drones, okay? And we will have some speed controllers for controlling the speed of the RPMs of the motors. And the propellers, the body frame, and battery power units. Like we can have traditional batteries, like lithium polymer, lithium ion batteries. And even there is a hybrid type of power, which is nowadays it is coming into the market, where you can use petrol as a fuel, and it is a kind of generator which is used for generating the current power for the drone units. And we have other payloads and sensors. Payload is nothing but the thing which we attach to the drone. Like, say, example, it is a camera. We are attaching a camera to a drone, then that is a payload, and other sensors like GPS and so on. So we have common payloads. This is a most commonly known payloads, visual cameras, thermal cameras, NDVI camera. So visual camera, it is a normal camera, whatever we use in drones. And thermal camera, it is a night vision kind of thing. Based on the heat signatures, we can able to differentiate different objects. So NDVI camera, it is especially used for agriculture purpose, for crop management and identifying vegetation index, monitoring crop health and so on. And LIDAR sensors, it is used for making a 3D model of any object, like 3D point clouds and so on. And we have a sprayer system, which is used for agriculture drones, and hazard detection sensors, like radioactivity or any other hazard, like chemical reaction, chemical accidents, incidents. If something happens like that, the drones can be deployed with hazard detection sensors in order to mitigate the issues. And applications. Let's talk about the real life use cases and applications. Mostly it is used for aerial photography, and the very good opportunity we have is the next thing is the drone delivery system, aerial delivery system. And it is mostly nowadays used by the surveying and mapping by most of the companies, and disaster management. We are currently using for locust control and precision agriculture. This is a very big thing. And I'll be talking about this in a little bit. An opportunity section, I'm coming to that. Law enforcement, something we wanted to focus on law enforcement is not only the surveillance and reconnaissance part, it is also like crash investigation and drone forensics, how the incidents took place. And the law people, like advocates and police officers, they should know how to use this for collecting evidence and what are the parts of drones, and lots of things involved there in the law enforcement. And industrial visual inspections, it is used for visualizing, like inspecting wind turbines, solar panels for fault detection, and it is used for thermal inspection of solar panels, and lots of things involved in flare inspection, and things are there. So this is a mostly like commercial parts. These are the things which is actually going to make money for the companies. This is a real life problems which customer has. But the thing which I see is the regulation part, which people have to understand, because a regulation is going to affect the safety, and it is going to ensure the safety for the drone users, potential consumers. So according to the DGCA, we have this is actually drone is called as like RPA. They have mentioned it is a RPA, remotely piloted aircraft. So they have classified those things into five categories: nano, micro, small, and medium. Most of the people from drone industry may know this. And nano category, it is a toy category, below 250 grams. You don't need any special permission to operate that. And you can fly with some height altitude restrictions. And we have micro and small, medium, large categories. These are the drones which need some kind of special features. Okay, so I'll talk about the features, but before flying the drone, we need to know what are the authorities we have to go for, and what are the permissions we have to get. So if you want to get an import clearance, you have to go for DGCA. And if you need to get an import license, you have to go for DGFT. and security clearance. We have to go for MHA and MOD for survey permissions. This is what mentioned in the guidelines of the DGCA drone draft rules. This is what they mentioned it. So if you want to get like violation permissions, like if some incidents happen, you have to go for local police office, so local police station. And if you need to go and do a survey or mapping in the border areas of a country, you have to get a monitoring and air defense clearance from IAF. So they have given certain forms where you have to fill that forms and you have to submit. And these forms are available in dgca.nic.in. So you can go there, and it is the government is working very hard to make this process very easy for everyone. And it has crossed lots of milestones. I have seen very great improvements in this draft rules and regulations. So the rules says, and the drone must have certain features in order to be compatible and eligible to operate within the Indian airspace. So every drone should have a NPNT. That is nothing but no permission, no takeoff. It is kind of software as well as hardware kind of restriction, which is given to a drone. Without a permission from the central government, you should not take off and you cannot take off. That should be the features of a drone. And you need that UIN. Most of the drone users nowadays got this UIN, unique identification number for drones. And except nano category, that has been exempted. Like if you need to fly more than 60 meters, you have to get UAOP, unmanned aerial aircraft operator permit. So this is actually, I think this is going to be provided by the approved DGCA, like flight training organizations listed. Currently, I think it is last week, to my knowledge, it has been 14 flight training organizations has been approved for providing pilot trainings across country. And they will be helping us to get trained pilot. And once if we are trained and certified pilot, we can able to get UAOP, which we can use to fly above 60 meters of height. And till that, without any permissions, you can fly only in visual line of sight. Your drone should not deviate from your sight, and it have to fly in your sight alone. And it should have other features like GPS sensors, return to home functionalities. If something happens, some failure happens, your drone should come back to your launch location. That is a functionality, that is a feature, return to home is. And strobe lights, if you're flying at low light conditions, the strobe lights at the red and green, starboard and port lights, okay? And NPNT with GSM or 3G, 4G technologies, which is used for getting the permission artifacts from the digital sky platform, the central, like that is a permission which will be, if requested, say I wanted to fly today and I should have got the permission yesterday itself. So I will be applying, this is the area I'm going to fly and this is how much altitude I'll be flying. So according to that, the approvals will be sent to the drone, like when you take your drone to the field for any projects. So your approvals will be available on your GCS systems. And night flights are not allowed. So other things are like barometers, geofence, collision avoidance. It is all like collision avoidance. This is a little bit of a technological challenge which we are facing in the R&D. And in order to mitigate all these things, we actually have lots of developer platforms. The companies which develop end-to-end solutions, they use our open source as well as they develop from very scratch, like from the beginning of the single line of the code, they develop everything for their company. But in developer platform, if we are going for open source development, what these are the features we look for? It should support manual, semi-autonomous, autonomous flight modes. Autonomous flight modes in the sense you'll be sending the flight plans previously, and it will be recorded in the autopilots, and the autopilots executes the flight plan automatically without any controller input. Without the pilot, the autonomous flights will work. And path planning softwares and SDKs. This is a software which is needed for controlling the drone. And it should be present in your computers. Like most people use transmitters for controlling manually, but softwares and SDK, software development kit, it is mandatory for developing proprietary flight modes or proprietary softwares. You need to check for is that SDKs are available. So additional ports for integrating additional sensors, and it should support cross platforms. We have our mobile phones, we have tablets, we have Mac, right? And some people you prefer to use Linux operating system, some people use Windows. Like it should support cross platform, and that's where we have to see, because this thing will come to the when we are launching our product. So the product should not cause any trouble. Like it should be compatible with all platforms. And general features like processing speed, we see how fast the bits are being executed. It is a little bit of a technical thing. So companion support and integration. This is a very, very important feature we look for, because companion support and integration is nothing but you're giving a pocket-sized computer as a brain to the autopilot system. So it is a combination of like a laptop combined together on autopilot system, which actually fitted together in the onboard drone. So you can write n number of any programming languages in order to command and control this drone. Like you don't have to work on firmware level, hardware level. You can have some APIs which is used for controlling the drones. So you should look for well-tested libraries like Python, JavaScript for dashboards, web dashboards, and other cloud applications. Because cloud is going to be the next part. Like I'll be talking about that. So widely used to developer platform, it is currently the NPNT supports Autopilot, which is nothing but the open source drone software, which is actually the flight controller. The Autopilot is nothing but the PixHawk Autopilot. So it supports currently the NPNT support. Like they have a library which can be integrated with this software in order to deploy that. So also it supports SITL software in the loop and the hardware in the loop, which is for simulating your code before launching your product or before testing any features. We will be testing on this simulated part. And it supports various vehicle types, not only quadcopter, hexacopter. It supports rovers, underwater vehicles, and lots of different types of drones. And it also supports the companion PC. You can integrate onboard pocket-sized computers like Raspberry Pi, Intel Edisons, and so on. And it is very well advanced because it has been in the industry for nearly about 12 years of development. Lots of features has been developed, and it is very well documented. So with the very active community, so we can go for it. That is why the feature NPNT feature has been built on this. And OpenTX, it is another open source platform which we need to focus on. As a developer, we focus on number of channels, how many channels we need, like how many control surfaces we are going to control, and the operating frequency, transmission power, range. This is what we actually look for when we are choosing our transmission. So it is actually for manual control and semi-autonomous control. For autonomous control, we go for GCS, ground control station, which is nothing but it comes with different types of hardwares. Like these are the different types of hardwares, the autopilot systems, autopilot, open pilot, and Paparazzi, Pixok, and these are kind of hardwares. It is all available easily in the market. But we should look for other things like software integrations. These are some softwares, Mission Planner, Open Pilot, and Paparazzi. And these have to be integrated with those things. It should be easily available. So that is what we look for. And once if we know all these things, these are the platforms and these things are available, and we should know, we should have some technical capabilities in order to start a career and business into the drone industry. So if you're someone is looking for a job, these are the highly recommended skills we look for in any engineers. Electronic circuits and design. This skill is used for analyzing autopilot circuits and so on, developing and changing the features and so on. Embedded system, programming expertise in C on common programming languages like Python and JavaScript and so on. And basic skills are like STM32, that is a microcontroller in most of the flight controllers we see. STM32, it's a very great for its processing speed, as I mentioned in the previous slides. And he should have, he or she should have the integration and troubleshooting skills, how to integrate all these components together. Like I told in the previous slide, we have different drone systems, transmitters, receivers, flight controller, ESC, motors, propellers, right? So he should be comfortable with integrating and troubleshooting any problems, and he should be able to calibrate, do a test flight, and he should be like a all-rounder. So these are the technical skills we look for when hiring some people. So it is a must-known industry skill, must-have industry skills. And other opportunities, like business opportunities, if you're from different industries, like agriculture or different industries, the one of the most important opportunity you have is the Indian made drones. Like it should be made in India, or every part and each and every microcontrollers, and from the flight controllers to the softwares, because it is going to ensure the safety of the country, because we don't want to implement the open source things into directly into defense industry. So we need to develop indigenous products. So Indian made components, this is a very great opportunity to enter into the market. So from motors to the all the electronic parts, which have to be made under Indian companies, Indian manufacturers. So embedded systems, that is where I was talking about. That is why I was talking about embedded system and those skills. So of other opportunities like photography in the cinematography field, they have lots of needs for taking the beautiful shots, drone shots, but they are using this other countries like Chinese drones, because it is all vast in nowadays, and it is not easily trackable. You cannot easily track the drone. That is a major issue faced by authorities. And drone delivery system. So if you know how to develop a platform for drone delivery, like you have to provide end-to-end solution from dashboard to the drone to the delivery service. So it is a very big opportunity, and scope is very, very great. And surveying and mapping, it is done by most of the companies across. So it is because this is where our new schemes are coming under our government to initiate a mapping of the whole country. And we are going to, they're under the Department of Survey, they are going to deploy lots of drones for doing this. So we have visual inspections like wind turbine inspection and oil and gas pipeline inspection. Those are untouched fields, like the oil and gas industry will be very good, as well as the renewable energy industry will be mass benefiting from visual inspections. It is going to help them cut the cost of the labor involved. Agriculture, we going to have, as I mentioned, it is going to, because we have lots of farmers. Farmers need people who wants to fertilize or spray pesticides across their field, because due to the labor shortage, they couldn't able to handle that problem. So when the drones are deployed, it is going to help them in very large way. So, and UTM, it is a unmanned traffic management. So unmanned traffic management. So if you're from a company who can handle the airspace traffic management, if you can able to develop a software and come up with a solution for monitoring and in order to ensure the safety of not making collisions between drone, the UTM comes into that part. And drone security, and it should be in the perspective of cyber security I'm talking about. So the communication protocol, it should be encrypted, decrypted, like lots of things are involved where we have to ensure the safety of hardware failure systems, software failure systems. What will happen next? What is the next thing will happen? So in that perspective, drone security has lots of opportunities, because if we can assist any drone crash incidents for any insurance companies, if they have insured the drones, so we can be like help the insurance companies, law enforcement officers in order to do drone forensics and so on. So we are about to conclude. Like some developments, I'll talk about the final thoughts and developments going on. So when it comes to safety, blockchain in manufacturing is going to help track drone activities and ensure safety environment, because the problem with nowadays is anyone can able to buy any drone component, and if with proper skill, they can build any drone. That is a very big threat. So if it goes to wrong minds, so think about what will happen. So in that perspective, we need to know who's handling those components. Are they certified and qualified? Not only we have to see such thing, we have to implement blockchain. Say if I'm a manufacturer, I'm doing a flight controller product. So if I implement blockchain in my flight controllers, so I know which consumer has bought that flight controller, so I can able to monitor and give that give a dashboard for government authorities to monitor the airspace activities. For we can give this monitoring activities control to the IAF and any defense forces. So firmware encryption to avoid configuration tampering. This is happening. Even if NPNT is implemented, there are lots of complications, because it is even in the beta, it is all in testing stage, and it is being getting approved day by day. It has unknown bugs. I'm not sure, but it will have bugs. So anyone can able to tamper those informations, and lots of issues are there. So it have to be ensured, firmware encryption and lots of things have to be done. And decentralized cloud infrastructure is going to help governments to monitor drone activities. That what I mean by that is every drone in future, it is going to be operated not only by humans, it is going to be very autonomous. So these things will be connected to 5G or 6G technologies, and it will be directly controlled from anywhere in the world. So we can have a labor force, a pilot force in our India, and we can even operate the drones, which is actually working on US through 5G or 6G technologies. So the cloud infrastructure for such technologies are being very rapidly developed. Like it is decentralized means it should not be easily accessible by the public. It should be controlled by the proper respective government authorities in order to monitor rogue drone activities. So setting the manufacturing standards, it is going to help to monitor all these activities. Setting a manufacturing standards for blockchain, integration with manufacturing drone components, and decentralized cloud infrastructure, and lots of things. So, and a companion integrated advanced autopilot, which is nothing but the integration of artificial intelligence with Internet of Things. This is what I was talking about in the previous slide, the cloud infrastructure. So if autopilot is having a companion support, and it, when it is integrated with internet, it can be not only controlled from anywhere in the world, but it can be easily tracked, and you can easily monitor the drone activities. So we need such cloud infrastructures where we can control the drones through the softwares, not only through the hardwares. So cybersecurity for drone technology. So this is a very good opportunity. In the perspective, if any companies want to develop, they have to focus on integrating other technologies with their autopilots and so on. Like cloud technologies, big data. It is going to, IoT is related with big data and somehow, and AI is related with IoT. It is all smart devices. So cybersecurity will be our next concern for drone technologies. So it is very happening. Like recently we have came across our Twitter accounts has been hacked, and the Bitcoin issues were going on in 2 weeks ago. So that is a very, big concern for any cyber infrastructures. So end-to-end solution, who can provide from hardware to the software support, and cloud infrastructures for unmanned traffic management, because once if we have cloud infrastructure, it is easy to track and monitor, so we can easily navigate the drone systems. So all these things will be playing a very important role in e-commerce delivery system, as well as the agriculture. So these will be the two major economic contributions will be happening in the future, delivery system as well as agriculture, because the Indian market is very wide. So lots and lots of people and lots of scopes and lots of skills are there. So we have very great opportunities. Because when we are deploying, say, for example, agriculture drones, we need operators, we need, it is going to help to get lots of job opportunities, because we can give opportunities for pilots, drone maintenance engineers, and whatnot, drone developers, drone coders, and lots of people is going to be get jobs. And some key challenges I wanted to talk about. Hardware and software standards, as I mentioned, it have to be standardized, the protocols for manufacturing such hardware and software. And the technology is growing very fast. So the regulations or policies, whatever the government is coming up with, it is having some bit of, it is not easy to capture that much technological growth nowadays because of fast growing technology. So it is harder to regulate these things, come up with new policies, and we have to keep on updating the policies. That is a very big challenge. And traffic management with environment safety, we have to think about bird hits and other natural things which were going to get affected because of using this drone technologies. Privacy issues, cybersecurity threats. What if the drone has some vulnerability and it has been taken down by an hacker? So how safe we are going to improve that? So technology barriers are like endurance of a drone, how long it can fly, and sensor integrations and its collision avoidance systems. And there are some government entities which is going to be exempted from using drones with such thing. So it is going to be a law enforcement or disaster management units. So those drafts are being, those policies are being drafted. And we need to set up a proper manufacturing units and improve the skill sets of the graduates. So that's going to be very helpful. And by saying all this thing, I'm at the end of this presentation. So I hope you guys enjoyed the presentation and you learned a lot. And it is a small promotion about our company background. And our company is HR Tech 24. It is a parent company. We have two divisions, Tech 24 Aviation, which deals with the aviations and drone related product service R&D. And Transnational, it is a institute for tech intelligence and counterterrorism. We help corporates and government sectors, different government sectors, to improve their security and how to counter internal threats also. So Sanjay North and Gautam Banerjee are the co-founders of this company. And we are working with different parts of nations. We have a Simlat, which is nothing but a simulator training for drones. We have tied with the Israel and UK companies, 360 ISR, in order to provide such infrastructure for delivering high quality trainings. So we also work closely with Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and Sectoral Trade Course Committee, STCC. And we also work with the Directorate General of Training on framing this drone training curriculum. We are into basically into education and training industry. So we offer certain courses, which is going to help you to get lots of knowledge about drone technologies, which I was talking about in the whole webinar. So you can download this presentation in this URL if you want to go through this later. And if you have any questions, now you can fire up your questions. So you can follow me on LinkedIn, and we can you can visit our drone and security website for more information about our company. And you can join the Telegram channel for upcoming events like this, webinars and courses and so on. Thank you for your wonderful time. I value your time. And now it's time for Q&A. Let's answer your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Sundaresan. And prior to that, thank you, Mr. Singh, for such enlightening presentations. I think this was very, very informative. And we definitely have a few questions coming up from the participants. So to the first one that we have is for Mr. Sundaresan, which says, what is the level required for required of electronics and circuit design? I'll just repeat, what is the level required of electronics and circuit design for developing drones?
I couldn't able to interpret that question properly. So level in the sense, sure. The skill.
Yeah, whosoever has asked the question, I think he can be online and he can ask as well, please. I'll just repeat once again, Sundaresan, since we are not having any kind of answer. So it is, what is the level required of electronics and circuit design?
I couldn't able to interpret that question properly. So from my interpretation, I'm going to answer this question. So level in the sense, in the skill level, I'm going to explain. So okay. Basic electronics like sensors, gyroscopes, accelerometers, and how the microcontroller, you can integrate that microcontroller together, and how you can program a firmware and develop a firmware, and how you can develop the softwares. This is how the level is going to improve. So you'll be basically starting with the very open source projects, like with the very basic skills of C++ for developing a very small understanding the controllers and the PID controllers, control theory behind that, and sensor fusion technologies. And these are some concept levels we have to understand before getting your hands on such things. So understanding from the microcontroller level to the how the software works, like how this compiling, all these things are done. So it should be the level we have to go like step by step. We have to go very start with very basic microcontrollers from 8-bit microcontrollers. And then we have to go for 32-bit, like STM32 series I was talking about, because the registers and memories, lots of things are involved. If you are having a very good basic understanding of 8-bit microcontrollers, then you can shift for 32-bit microcontrollers eventually, if you are a beginner.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Sundaresan. I hope this satisfied the person who actually asked that question. But if you have anything more, please go into the chat, or you can ask directly on the system. Second question that we have is again for you. Is there any website for open source software and hardware?
Yeah, website. It is autopilot.org. I can drop this things in chat box, I think. It is autopilot.org. Autopilot.org and px4.io. These are the main things. To get started, go with autopilot.org. That is an open source, very good platform I was talking about. And then you can go for px4.io.
And there's a second part to this question, which says, can you elaborate on the embedded chips type numbers?
It is a STM32 series. So it is F4, F7, F2 controllers are there. So there are certain autopilot.org, like autopilot flight controllers, works on STM32F series. So majorly on F4 and F7. So it can be ported to other series also, like F2 and F1 flight controllers. But F1 flight controllers, it is all actually playing a very good role in other open source platforms like Betaflight or CleanFlight and so on. So those things are used for FPV racing drones. So when you're going for professional level and comparing the speeds and the software compatibilities, the series are like F4 and F7, STM32, F4 and F7. That is what the series is going to be.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sundaresan. And one question we have, I think I'll pass it on to Mr. Singh. The question is, do you have any methodology to separate drones from civil aircrafts?
Yes. The DECA and the Ministry of Civil Aviation has come out with the policy to have the drone routes and the level for to operate. Draft is already in the public domain, and very soon the ministry is going to notify it. The draft is already there to avoid the collision between the drone and the aircrafts.
Right. This is all we could gather from the chat box, but we have still about 5 minutes time. If there is any further query, we can really have the participants directly asking Mr. Singh and Mr. Sundaresan by raising a hand, please.
Any knowledge required for mission language like NASM? It is an assembly language. In order to work with the reverse engineering and analysis of firmware signatures, you may need that such kind of skills, like mission language codes, assembly codes, and in order to understand how the memory works inside the flight controller, you need such knowledge. But it is not mandatory for developments of applications.
Thanks, Mr.
Just to add on, sir, this is Shayantan from Bengal Chamber. I can see there are two hands being raised, one by Mr. Arijit Das, and the second one who has logged in from Samsung SMJ260.
Okay, so we can please allow them to ask questions.
You can post your questions in the chat box.
Okay.
Or else you can also directly ask the question.
Yeah, I'm Arijit Das. I have a question over here. Like you were talking about air taxis. So yep. The regulations for from DCGA, would it be, where would it fall? Would it be something of a new category, or it would fall under civil aviation or in drone aviation?
It is a like it is going to fall under civil aviation because it is going to carry passengers. It is not going to be unmanned vehicle. So and lots of safety considerations have to be done. So I think I'm not sure, but from my experiences, I can say it is going to fall under civil aviation, and it is going to be categorized under aircrafts. So not a drone.
Mr. Singh, anything to add to that?
Yes. Anything which is to be manned and piloted in person will fall in civil aviation policies. It will be treated as an aircraft at whatever altitude it flies. And drones are unmanned equipments, irrespective of size.
Okay. So it's irrespective of altitude. If there is a man in it, it should be an civil aircraft.
This civil aviation policy considered as an aircraft.
Thank you, Mr. Singh, Mr. Sundaresan. And there was another person, Shayantan.
Yes, but I think he has not posted any question in the chat box also. But I can find a final question from Mr. Abhay Kumar Jain. Is it possible that we can identify that drone is registered or not for security reasons?
It is possible only if you can able to identify the operator or the pilot who was flying. So, because without, there is no such thing which can wirelessly or using RF, we cannot able to identify whether the drone is registered or not. If it is flying above your home or in your property, you cannot easily identify whether that drone is registered or not. So, I think there is no easy thing. It is not possible to identify easily, but if you can able to locate the pilot and the operator, you can question them whether they are registered and authorized pilots by the authorities. In that way, you can verify the securities. SSR transponders, like we can use transponders for tracking the aircrafts, like we use some. You may be, if you're not aware of RTL SDR, software defined radios, using that you can easily track the aircrafts. So same kind of thing can be implemented with a drone, where the software defined radio equipments, which is easily available nowadays, using that you can able to track the drones also.
Great, thanks Mr. Sundaresan. Any more questions? Okay, with that, I guess we are coming to the end of the session. So ladies and gentlemen, we have, would like to close the session, but before that, I would like to thank each one of you for your very kind and active participation in today's online discussion and making it so interesting. Big thank you, of course, to the expert panelists, Mr. Virender Singh and Mr. Sundaresan N, for their excellent presentations and very informative tour to civil aviation industry challenges and what the drones could do for it. I mean, how the drones are being helpful towards various aviation related activities. And to Mr. Sundaresan for taking us through the various features of drone, the various applicabilities of drone. And we have all really enjoyed it quite a lot. There has been a lot of learning and takeaways for all of us, I believe. Finally, for making this session possible, a very big thank you to GAP EV LLP and Tech24 Aviation, members of the Manufacturing and MSME Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and all the concerned officials of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Before I close, finally, just to say that Mr. Sundaresan has already mentioned about HR Tech 24's activities regarding training on drones. And they are also working with Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry in this area. So with this, I would like to conclude the session. Thank you all once again.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much.